thanks so much for sharing your garden with us. Now we're going to be turning our attention to the poetic and aesthetic side of water conservation. And I'm joined by Kenneth Francis from the landscape firm Surroundings. Ken is from Santa Fe, New Mexico, but Surroundings now has an office here in Austin, and was your firm was a finalist in the Sea Home Design Competition for the reuse of the Sea Home Power Plant downtown. Congratulations for that, and welcome to Central Texas Gardener.
Thank you so much.
I should say welcome to Austin as well.
Yes, love Austin.
It's a great town, and we're lucky to have a talent like you coming to our community. Your approach to landscaping is unique, and we're going to be walking people through kind of the design concepts that really come to bear in terms of the natural conservation elements that you really lead your aesthetic.
Absolutely.
Tell me a little bit more about kind of the how you set the context when you start a project.
Well, first, we really believe in an extensive site analysis. It has to be part of our process. If we don't, and we're just designing something, it doesn't really have the gravity and input that a site analysis can give us. So we really love to just, you know, get in and start to look at where's water moving on the site? Where is it getting collected? Where can it be captured? Where can it be moved? We look at view sheds. We look at circulation systems. We look at a lot of different aspects around a house, a commercial project, a public project, first before we even hit, you know, pencil to paper to get the design going. And what it does is it really gives us an opportunity to make this a unique design, because it really comes from the things that it's telling us.
Now, a lot of what we're going to be talking about today, we have illustration points for, and this is of a beautiful residence in northern New Mexico. And the first piece of analysis that you show really is where does the water come off the roof, which is critically important, right?
Exactly. And so, you know, using Google Earth, or we get up on a ladder if the house doesn't exist, or the residence, or sorry, the commercial project doesn't exist in Google Earth, and we look at where all the water is moving, and then start to direct where we might capture it, where we might move it. You know, we look at solar aspect for plant colonies around the project. So we start to look at it, you know, hands-on from the start.
Right. Well, these are, of course, the critical things. But you take the water and you do all sorts of different things with it. That was one of the things. I mean, obviously, you capture some of it in cisterns and other kinds of things, right?
Correct.
But you also move it across the property, directing it direct for to plantings that require.
We do, and you know, a lot of projects are using subgrade cisterns these days, underground cisterns to hold water. And for large projects or urban projects that don't have a lot of space, that can be a really great solution. What we've found in Santa Fe is that it's getting too prohibitively expensive, and our storms all come at once. And so the cistern fills up, and then you know, and it's of course usually monsoon season in the summertime, and then you use the water up.
Yeah.
So how do we move water poetically across the site and funnel it to where we want it to be? So the project that we're discussing, which we're calling Woven Plains, is out on this flat area of just north of Santa Fe, and we moved water on that very flat site in really creative ways to focus it to the plant design that we made. So,
well, anybody who visits Santa Fe remembers the Escapias, the ancient, well, the near ancient colonial ditches, really,
correct,
that were designed for agricultural purposes.
400 years old is ancient in America, right?
Right.
So, we in this project created an Escapia that captures. They were having a lot of problems with their driveway, and it was puddling up with water, and so we created a conduit to collect the water from that, as well as the overflow from a cistern, into this stormwater Escapia, is what we call them. And in this particular project, we actually lined it. We didn't want the water to stay there. We wanted it to get to what we called an oasis
zone. You're carrying it. You don't want it to permeate.
Correct.
Yeah.
So it's kind of, in a way, more of the traditional way of using an Escapia to carry the water to irrigate an orchard, a farm, or whatever
that
might be.
In this case, a beautiful raised vegetable garden.
And so
in part.
Exactly. And then and this also funnels, the clients really wanted aspen trees. Everyone loves aspen trees in Santa Fe, but they're finicky. They take some water, and so we gave them their aspen trees, but we gave them by giving it lots of water whenever the water does come, which we've been having a really great rainfall this year.
And curse you.
Yes, it's been fantastic. And we also did some really interesting things. I mean, a lot of the things that we do are really simple. Mm-hmm. They're really simple ways of of construction and moving water. Mm-hmm. The other method that we used was we actually created gaps in this terrace for water collection. So it's a permeable paver, and that carries water through a pipe into subsurface scoria wicks underneath the aspen trees. So we're grabbing the water from these rainstorms, carrying it to that oasis zone, and it's being held in scoria rock. And the scoria rock is a kind of volcanic microporous rock. One of the problems we have, and I think Austin also has, is the water holding capacity of our environment. I think yours is limestone.
Right.
Is it the storms come and it goes through and it's gone.
Right.
And we have a similar issue. Our storms come really quick, and it's either highly erosive and does some really nasty things to our environment.
That happens here too.
Or it goes right through the ground and you don't get any holding capacity. So we created this as a way to hold water underneath the aspen trees.
And the scoria lasts for a long time, which is a great thing.
It does, yes.
Now, I mentioned, or I kind of misstepped a moment ago when I talked about the vegetable garden. This is actually adjacent to the cistern.
That's correct.
But the water doesn't travel there, but it's immediately adjacent to it, so that's great. And a beautiful way to have a vegetable garden or a garden period in Central Texas as well, that is just thinking over these raised beds.
And our clients do a fantastic job of raising some great vegetables, herbs, flowers, and they're using the stormwater from that cistern. Mm-hmm. There is supplemental irrigation, in the beds when it's needed. If there's no rain, we've been very lucky this year. But so they can get that great rainwater. Right. The vegetable gardens, I have one at my house, my family. We have a little raised beds, not as nice as those, that are helpful. They love the rainwater. So.
Well, another aspect of the work that we're looking at here is that you've considered the landscape, the viewscape, so to speak.
Viewsheds,
but you've also considered the soundscape here in a very creative way.
Yes.
The folks who are your clients here. Had a real problem with sound because they were adjacent to a highway, right?
To a road, but it was a gravel road. There are a lot of gravel roads in Santa Fe still, so it makes a lot of noise.
Okay, so noisy, right?
Right. So we created a berm in their kind of master gardens near their bedroom that gave them both privacy from the lights from the cars, because the way the road was, it just almost kind of pointed right into their bathroom and into their bedroom. And so we created both a visual block, but we also created one that was for sound.
Mm-hmm.
The berming up of the earth really just took that sound down to a lower level. It just, especially when you sit down and you're just right below it, it makes for just a really great kind of intimate space on this very otherwise flat, open landscape.
And it has the berms, when they're backed with the steel and the way that you've used them, they have such beautiful sculptural quality to them. It's landscaping in a very real sense of the word.
And what was a really beautiful surprise about that, because we've done really kind of squared, contemporary, edged, materials. That one started to follow, when we got it in, put it in, and we looked off into the distance to the Jemez mountain range that's off in the distance. Mm-hmm. There it was, right? This like echo of the Jemez. So it was kind of a beautiful moment. We don't think of everything, but it was one of those beautiful moments that happens.
Well, you've thought of a lot of things here. You've a lot of reuse of materials, for example. The bricks were reused materials.
Right.
And you've embedded into the bricks and the patio spaces some lighting fixtures that I find really fascinating and very promising.
They're really great. They're a solar LED light. They can charge up for up to 3 days of light. If there was ever a storm that lasted 3 days in Santa Fe instead of 3 minutes, it would stay lit.
Right.
And so they just need a day's charge, and they can last for three. So.
All right. Well, Kenneth, it's been a great pleasure visiting with you, and I know that certainly enjoyed touring the beautiful landscape that you've created. The firm again is Surroundings. New to Austin, Texas, well established in Santa Fe, New Mexico. Thanks so much for being a part of Central Texas Gardener.
Thank you so much for having me.
Okay, and coming up next is our friend Daphne.